Go ahead, sir. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. With a deep sense of gratitude on behalf of ASSOCHAM, Bharat Jaiswal, Regional Director, ASSOCHAM, would like to welcome you all in today's Knowledge Management Virtual Meet on Skills and Vocational Training Awards, a step towards Atmanirbhar Bharat. Skilling of workforce is an essential for achieving the milestone of Atmanirbhar Bharat. Keeping in view, ASSOCHAM as a responsible chamber organizes today's virtual meet and awards. Today's program is divided in two parts. One is inaugural and awards ceremony, and second is panel discussion. We are honored to have with us today Her Excellency Srimati Draupadi Murmu, Honorable Governor of Jharkhand, one of the most humble leader I've met in recent past. I feel elated in welcoming Mr. Nawab Malik, Honorable Minister for Skill Development and Entrepreneurship, Government of Maharashtra, a visionary leader and a true advocate of common people. With immense pleasure, I would like to welcome Dr. Sumit Susilan, Chairman ASSOCHAM Jharkhand State Skill Development Council and Chairman International Institute of Aviation Private Limited. To bring about the industry's perspective, we have along with us Mr. C.B. Chakravarti, Vice President, Amway India Enterprises Private Limited. We are honored to have with us today Dr. Jitendra Das, Director for School of Management, New Delhi. In today's second part of the program, we have with us expert panelists, namely Ms. Jaya Mishra, President, Sri Sankaracharya Technical Campus, Vilai, Mr. Sanjay Singh, Director, Center of Technology and Entrepreneur Development, Ms. Archana Garg, CEO, Power Talk with Archana, Mr. Rahul Dasgupta, Director, Globeson Business Schools, along with Dr. Sumit Susilan and Mr. C.B. Chakravarti. And the present chair for today's program is Dr. Jitendra Das, Director for School of Management. They will share their expert views and steps to be taken for achieving the goal of Atmanirbhar Bharat. It's my pleasure to request Mr. Chandra Bhushan Chakravarti, Vice President, Amway India Enterprises Private Limited. He is an experienced professional with a demonstrative history of working in the consumer goods industry. Mr. Chakravarti, I'd request you to bring industry's perspective in skill development. Over to you, Mr. Chakravarti.
Sure, Bharat. Thank you. And it's always a pleasure being part of ASSOCHAM's initiatives which you take on behalf of ASSOCHAM, including this Knowledge Management and Virtual Award Meet 2020. And I must also say it's a privilege to have amongst us the Honorable Governor of Jharkhand and the Honorable Minister in Government of Maharashtra, Mr. Nawab Malik. And also, I'll acknowledge the presence of eminent dignitaries on the panel, my panelists, speakers, and all those who have logged in. I'll start by sharing a little bit about myself for those who are not aware. I represent Amway India Enterprises Private Limited, which happens to be India's largest direct selling FMCG company. And this is an affiliate of Amway Corporation, which is a global company based in Michigan, USA. We have an extremely varied range of product portfolio, starting from nutrition, beauty, personal care. So we are an FMCG company. And for the past 60 years, we have been creating and nurturing millions of entrepreneurs across the globe through the Amway business opportunity. And talking about India, we have over 5 lakh direct sellers who are associated with us as business partners, owning and operating their own Amway business. Now, coming to the topic at hand, you'll be surprised to know that the World Bank report, a recent World Bank report had estimated that there are more than 8 million jobs which are required in India every year. The working age population continues to increase by 1.3 million every month. So you can do the maths. There is a, if you know, you have got only 7 million jobs created annually in our country, there is bound to be a gap in the employment. And this requires urgent attention. And to address this, the various state governments as well as the union government. Am I audible, Bharat? I think.
Yeah, you're audible.
Okay. So I think there was somebody. Okay. This huge gap is being addressed by the various state governments as well as the government of India by focusing on entrepreneurship, self-development, self-employment, and the skilling initiatives. We at Amway also, we have aligned our strategy with the government's agenda. And so way back, you know, when PM Modi launched this Kaushal Bharat, Kushal Bharat campaign or Skill India campaign with the objective of equipping and empowering crores of Indians with various skills, we also made our small contribution towards this cause. And what we did was we officially tied up with a government body called the Retailers Association Skill Council of India, also known as RASCI. And we developed, co-created a training module and certification for our Amway distributors. So happy to share that we have successfully, you know, trained and certified over 11,000 Amway direct sellers. So that was a small contribution from our part. And not only that, when we talk about Atmanirbhar, it is back in 2015 when we, had our own, set up our own manufacturing plant, which is a gold standard manufacturing plant in Tamil Nadu at an investment of 600 crores. We had, as a part of a deliberate strategy, moved away from importing products to manufacturing most of the products locally through our plant. And so we have, already we had started making our contribution towards making us self-reliant and India self-reliant, also creating the huge, job opportunities and the ancillary business opportunities, which is associated with opening of, such large plant. So Bharat, in the interest of time, I would like to close with my initial comments here. And with such a distinguished panel with us, I'm sure by the end of this webinar, the participants who have logged in will have really solid insights and solutions on skilling, entrepreneurship, and being Atmanirbhar. So with that, I'll thank everyone and I'll pass on the mic back to you, Bharat, to take this program forward.
Thank you, Mr. Chakravarti. We totally agree. Skill manpower is the most valuable asset any country can have. Now I request Dr. Jitendra Das, Director for School of Management and Institution in himself. With an enriched experience of around 4 decades, he has been a professor of marketing and the founder Dean Noida Campus of IIM Lucknow, with a BTech and MTech course from IIT Delhi and a doctorate from the University of Toronto. Over to you, Dr. Das.
It's not audible, Bharat.
Dr. Das, you have to unmute.
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Srimati Draupadi Murmu, Honorable Governor of Jharkhand, Mr. Nawab Malik, Honorable Minister for Minority Development, OCOF, Skill Development and Entrepreneurship, Government of Maharashtra, Mr. Bharat Jaiswal, the lead who has brought us together here, a very distinguished panel members with us this morning. It's a great pleasure to be with you this morning to share some of my quick views on Atmanirbhar Bharat. And at the outset, I would like to thank Asucham for taking up this topic, which is very important in terms of its timing and in terms of putting together thoughts together as to what all is required to be done. Now, when you look at Atmanirbhar Bharat, it is essentially means self-reliant India. So we need to look at it the way I see it, purely from two perspectives. One is getting away from import and therefore focusing on export. And the second part is generating employment. Now, the first part essentially focuses and lays a lot of emphasis on skill development and technology integration into our own manufacturing system. So government needs to put a lot of emphasis on the technology integration into our system, as well as the skill development across the manufacturing base. And the other part is looking at employment generation. So when you look at the technology integration, there is one aspect which we need to look at in terms of high-end technology and the low-end technology. So this is what government needs to put its mind together in terms of how to go about doing it. And the other aspect is the employment generation. So if you look at employment generation, you know, there's a concept called decentralized manufacturing. Now, traditionally, we have had these large manufacturing factories which would employ a large number of workers and, you know, at different levels, skill levels of employees. So the factory and the industrial locations, they'll all be concentrated in a particular area. Now, with this Atmanirbhar Bharat, I feel that it's about right time to focus on decentralizing these large factories also. So, you know, a concept like a decentralized manufacturing, that means entire manufacturing can be split into multiple components and given away for manufacturing in the adjoining area, right up to 400, 500 kilometers away, which is slightly different than the OEM concept, you know, original equipment manufacturer concept. And then that's how you go into what we call the MSME sector, you know, the medium, small and micro enterprises. And if you look at the data, we have approximately 11 crore people, which is 110 million people who are employed in MSME sector in India today. And the contribution of MSME to our GDP is approximately 29%. And contribution of MSME to our exports, the national export, is about 48%. So that's a large sector that we need to focus on. So if you split the large manufacturing into smaller units, then this is where in MSME, where a lot of employment can be generated, a lot of productivity can improve, and therefore there's a need to put a lot of focus on the skill development in that space. So with this brief view on Atmanirbhar Bharat, I'll close now. We have severe limitation of time, and I would like to thank Associam for giving us all this opportunity to share our views. Thank you very much.
It's an absolute delight to hear you. We will benefit from your enriched experience during the panel discussion. Now, with due permission from Her Excellency Srimati Draupadi Murmu, Honorable Governor of Jharkhand, and Mr. Nawab Malik, Honorable Minister of Skill Development and Entrepreneur, we'd like to go to the next part of the occasion, that is felicitation. The recommendable work is being done by many organizations throughout the country for making India a skill hub. And to felicitate them is just a thanksgiving on behalf of Associam, a gesture to thank them for all the restless work and sheer commitment on their part. We received many nominations from hook and corner of the country, and it is trying efforts from our jury members to shortlist 10 of them. We have our eminent jury member consists of Mr. Mukesh Sinha, co-founder and CEO, Gravitas AI Limited, based at United Kingdom. Mr. Rajesh Prasad, Director and CEO of Rams Services Private Limited. Mr. Ratin Badra, Director, Bungru. Mr. M.K. Gupta, founder and CEO, NIBM. Mr. Rajiv Gupta, Curator, Texas. Now the wait is almost over. And here I do announce the winner of prestigious Associam Skill and Vocational Training 2020 Awards. So the first award which is going to announce today is the Spirit of Self-Reliance Award, which goes to Dr. Jitendra Das, Director, Ford School of Management, New Delhi. The second award goes to for Best Organization, Providing Skills and Vocational Training to RGCSM Skills. Best Placement with Education, Training and Skill Development Award goes to Sri Shankaracharya Technical Campus. Education Entrepreneur of the Year Award goes to Mr. Rahul Das Gupta. He is Director for Brookshire Business Schools. University in Law of the Year Award goes to Hindustan Institute of Science and Technology. Best International Organization in Skill Development. This award goes to MWay India Enterprises Private Limited. Best NGO Skill Development Award goes to Center of Technology and Entrepreneurship Development. The next award goes to Best Vocational Training Provider, and it goes to Orient Fly Aviation Academy. Best Aviation Training Institute Award goes to International Institute of Aviation. Women Entrepreneur of the Year Award goes to Ms. Archana Garg, founder and the CEO, Power Talk with Archana Garg. Now I would humbly request our next speaker, who needs no introduction. He's a true advocate of common man, Mr. Nawab Malik, Honorable Minister for Skill Development and Entrepreneurship, Government of Maharashtra. Maharashtra is the land of leaders. And when it comes to contribution towards national workforce, it leads in his own way. Mr. Sabji, would request for your valuable insight on today's discussion on skills and vocational training.
मैडम एसोसिएशन के सभी पदाधिकारी और इस समिट में भाग लेने वाले सहभागी, निश्चित रूप से आत्मनिर्भर ये पिछले 70 सालों से सभी नेता और जिन लोगों ने नए भारत के निर्माण का सपना देखा था, उनकी चाहत है। प्रधानमंत्री मोदी जी ने भी घोषणा की है कि भारत निश्चित रूप से कई क्षेत्रों में हम कृषि क्षेत्र में आत्मनिर्भर हैं, लेकिन जो इंडस्ट्रियलाइजेशन नीड्स हमारी है, निश्चित रूप से उस क्षेत्र में आज भी हम अलग अलग टेक्नोलॉजी के क्षेत्र देशों पर निर्भर है। और हमारी कोशिश है और होनी भी चाहिए, और हम कोशिश करें हम सेल्फ रिलायंस हो और किसी भी दुनिया के अन्य देशों पे हम निर्भर ना रहे। निश्चित रूप से आज के समय में जब टेक्नोलॉजी का जमाना आया, तो टेक्नोलॉजी के साथ साथ बिना इन्वेस्टमेंट के कोई भी जो भी इंडस्ट्रियलाइजेशन होगा, जो भी हम चाहते हैं प्रोडक्टिविटी इंडिया में बने, तो कहीं ना कहीं इन्वेस्टमेंट की लीजिए। लेकिन सिर्फ इन्वेस्टमेंट और टेक्नोलॉजी से ही कोई भी इंडस्ट्री नहीं चलती। इसके लिए श्रम करने वाले, मेहनत करने वाले लोगों की जैसे जैसे समय बदलता है, विकास के मानक बदलते हैं, और समय के अनुरूप नए नए इन्वेंशन के द्वारा नई नई टेक्नोलॉजी आती है, और उस टेक्नोलॉजी के लिए काम करने वाला जो वर्क है उसकी भी बड़े डिमांड। निश्चित रूप से देश में आज हमारी जनसंख्या 130 करोड़ है। कई चर्चाएं होती हमारी जनसंख्या ही हमारी समस्या है, लेकिन अमृत सेन जी ने कहा कि हमारी जनसंख्या हमारी समस्या है, ये हमारा असेट है और उसका सही इस्तेमाल हो तो इससे हम ये बदल सकते हैं। जिस तरह से वर्ल्ड बैंक का डाटा आया कि हर साल कितने वर्कफोर्स की जरूरत है, लेकिन स्किल वर्कफोर्स की जरूरत है, ये भी हमसे स्वीकार कर रहा है। अलग अलग केंद्र सरकार हो, राज्य सरकार हो, प्रोग्राम करती है, लेकिन मेरा जो अनुभव है कि हम वर्क फोर्स को स्किलिंग के लिए तैयार करते हैं, लेकिन बड़े पैमाने पे उनका कहीं ना कहीं रोजगार का साधन है छोड़ के महीने दो महीने तीन महीने चार महीने स्किल ट्रेनिंग ले, कहीं ना कहीं उसमें उसका इंटरेस्ट नहीं हो। ऑन जॉब ट्रेनिंग अगर हो समय बहुत हर से मैं नहीं जाना चाहता, ऑनरेबल गवर्नर मैडम का भी एड्रेस होगा 11:30 बजे तक का हमारा समय कि निश्चित मेरे दो तीन सुझाव स्किलिंग करते समय दो चीजें अपग्रेडेशन करनी लगातार टेक्नोलॉजी में बनती है अपग्रेडेशन ऑफ स्किलिंग भी एक बड़ी हम एड्रेस करेंगे जो भी नीड साथ ही साथ ऑनबोर्ड स्किलिंग अगर हो किसी बच्चे को इंस्टीट्यूट में ट्रेन करना ठीक है वो ट्रेनिंग का एज हो तो ठीक है लेकिन 18 साल के बाद तो अगर हम ग्रुप में ट्रेनिंग देंगे आप आइए ट्रेनिंग लीजिए तो वो गरीब आदमी चाहता है कि हम कहीं ना कहीं रोजी रोटी 500 रुपये कमा सकते हैं तब तो जाके अपने आप प्रोग्राम ऐसे बनने चाहिए हम जो ट्रेनिंग के समय उसको कहीं ना कहीं हाथ में कुछ पैसे मिले तो भी ट्रेनिंग के प्रोग्राम हो सके। और एक सबसे बड़ा कंसर्न जो वर्क फोर्स है उसका कहीं ना कहीं इस तरह से हालात कि मजबूरी में लोग काम कर रहे हैं लेकिन क्या हम जितना उनको के श्रम के लिए देते हैं क्या उसके जीवन चलाने भर का वो पैसा है। तो हम स्किलिंग इस हद तक ले जाए कि अगर कोई मार्केट में अपना प्रोडक्ट बेचने जाता है खरीदार जो है वो अपनी मर्जी से लेता है बेस्ट कीमत कौन सी कीमत पे लेना है ये जो होने वाला है वो तय करता है। हमें लगता है इस हद तक की होनी चाहिए नहीं उसकी मास्टरी होनी चाहिए कि जो एम्प्लॉयर है उसको वो बार्गेन कर सके कि तो इतना पर डे या पर आवर हमें लगता है जब तक मैन पावर को ट्रेन करते हम इस प्रोग्राम नहीं देंगे जॉब ट्रेनिंग नहीं लेंगे और स्किलिंग में उस नहीं बनाएंगे हमें लगता है ठीक है आत्मनिर्भर भारत बनाना है लेकिन वर्क फोर्स को भी आत्मनिर्भर बनाना है बड़ी सोच से आगे बढ़ने में एक अच्छा कदम हो शुभकामनाएं वो सभी लोगों को दिया गया लोग अपने आइडियाज रखेंगे उसकी कोई भी चीजें निकल के आएगी जब डिस्कशन
After this inspiring word from Mr. Nawab Malik, Mantri Saab, I would like to thank him for taking time. I'd request and invite our next. भारत एक ऐसा देश है जहां परंपरा और आधुनिकता परिपाटी और बदलाव साथ साथ चलती है। स्किल इंडिया मिशन इसी सोच का हिस्सा है। आज हमारे साथ मौजूद हैं जो एक जनजातीय समाज में जन्मी और जीवन में संघर्ष का सामना करते हुए समाज को बदलने का काम किया और खासकर जनजातीय समाज को मुख्य धारा से जोड़ने का काम करती है और इसी उद्देश्य के साथ सेवा शुरू की समाज सेवा से वो राजनीति में आए और अब वो एक संवैधानिक पद पे आसीन है। मैं आज स्वागत करता हूं भारत की पहली महिला आदिवासी गवर्नर और मौजूदा महामहिम राज्यपाल झारखंड श्रीमती द्रौपदी मुर्मू जी का। आपकी गरिमाई उपस्थिति से हम सभी अभिभूत हैं। मैडम
सज्जन द्वारा आयोजित आज के वीडियो कॉन्फ्रेंस कार्यक्रम में सम्मिलित महाराष्ट्र सरकार के माननीय मंत्री श्री नवीन मल्लिक जी, उपस्थित देवियों स्वजनों और प्रतिभागीगण सभी को नमस्कार जोहार। सर्वप्रथम मैं इस प्रकार के कार्यक्रम के लिए आसोचाम के कार्यकर्ताओं को बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद देना चाहती हूँ क्योंकि ये समय की मांग है। वर्तमान हम सब जानते हैं लगभग पूरा विश्व नोवेल कोरोना वायरस से ग्रसित है हमारा देश और राज्य भी इस भीषण चुनौती का सामना कर रहे हैं। हमारे वैज्ञानिक वैक्सीन के निर्माण की दिशा में आगे बढ़ रहे हैं। आशा है कि शीघ्र ही जनमानस के बीच ये पहुंचेगा और कोरोना जैसे महामारी से निजात पाया जा सकेगा। इस प्रकार से कार्यक्रम में मैं अवश्य आती, लेकिन वर्तमान में परिस्थिति को ध्यान में रखते हुए हम सभी को सोशल डिस्टेंसिंग का पालन करना है, जहां आत्मिक संबंध और प्रगाढ़ हो। आज इस टेक्निक के माध्यम से आप सभी से जुड़े हूं और कार्यक्रम में भाग ले रही हूं। स्किल एंड वोकेशनल ट्रेनिंग अवार्ड जैसे कार्यक्रम का आयोजन में लोगों में प्रतियोगितात्मक भावना विकसित होती और उनमें निहित कला हुनर भी प्रखर होगी। हमारे यहाँ के लोग हुनरवंद है। ये मशीनरी काम, हस्तकला, अगरबत्ती निर्माण, बांस आधारित उद्योग, फूड प्रोडक्ट आदि विभिन्न क्षेत्रों में निपुण है। आवश्यक है सिर्फ उन्हें और प्रोत्साहित करने की। भारत की नवीनतम जनगणना के अनुसार वर्ष 2022 तक 2 करोड़ नए श्रमिकों का एक अनुमान श्रम बाजार में प्रवेश करेगा और कौशल प्रशिक्षण की आवश्यकता होगी, जबकि मौजूदा कार्यबल के लगभग 30 करोड़ श्रमिकों को उसी समय अवधि में अतिरिक्त कौशल प्रशिक्षण की आवश्यकता होगी। ये देश की औद्योगिक और आर्थिक वृद्धि के लिए एक महत्वपूर्ण आवश्यकता है। सरकार द्वारा इस दिशा में प्रयासरत है। स्किल इंडिया भारतीय युवकों की प्रतिभागी को विकसित करता है, ताकि उन्हें रोजगार प्राप्त हो सके। उनके तहत शहरों एवं ग्रामों सभी को प्रशिक्षण देने हेतु लक्ष्य रखा गया है, ताकि हमारा आत्मनिर्भर भारत का सपना साकार हो और देश दूसरे को निर्यात करे। इस उद्देश्य को प्राप्त करने के लिए विभिन्न योजनाओं के प्रस्ताव रखा गया है। मजदूरों को प्रशिक्षित करने और उनके कौशल के अनुसार उन्हें रोजगार प्रदान करने के लिए कौशल विकास की भूमिका महत्वपूर्ण हो जाती है। सर्वेक्षण के अनुसार कई कंपनियां अब ऐसे व्यक्तियों की तलाश में है जिनके पास न केवल शैक्षणिक योग्यता है बल्कि कौशल और अनुभव भी है, जो उन्हें काम करने के लिए तैयार रखता है। वैश्विक COVID-19 महामारी से लोगों के रोजगार एवं जीवन यापन पर प्रभाव पड़ा है। न केवल जखिम में लाखों लोग के स्वास्थ्य प्रभावित हुआ है बल्कि उनकी दीर्घकालीन आजीविका पर भी असर हुआ है। सरकार युद्ध स्तर पर प्रयासरत है, विभिन्न जन कल्याणकारी नीतियां चलाई जा रही है। सामाजिक और आर्थिक परिवर्तन के लिए हमें शिक्षा की दिशा में प्रयास करना होगा। एक अच्छी तरह से शिक्षित आबादी पर्याप्त रूप से ज्ञान और कौशल के न केवल आर्थिक विकास का समर्थन करने के लिए आवश्यक है बल्कि विकास के लिए एक पूर्व शर्त भी समावेशी होने चाहिए, क्योंकि ये शिक्षित और जो रोजगार के अवसर से सबसे अधिक लाभ उठाने के लिए खड़े हैं, जो विकास प्रदान करता है। कौशल और ज्ञान किसी भी देश के लिए आर्थिक और सामाजिक विकास की प्रेरक शक्ति है। उच्च और बेहतर कौशल वाले देश काम की दुनिया में चुनौतियां और अवसरों के अधिक प्रभावी ढंग से समायोजित करते हैं। भारत नॉलेज इकोनॉमी बनने की दिशा में उत्तरोत्तर आगे बढ़ता जा रहा है, इसीलिए ये महत्वपूर्ण हो गया है कि देश को कौशल की उन्नति पर ध्यान देना चाहिए और इन कौशलों के उभरते हुए आर्थिक परिवेश के लिए प्रासंगिक होना चाहिए। भारत दुनिया के उन कुछ देशों में से एक है जहां काम करने की उम्र की आबादी उन पर निर्भर लोगों की संख्या से अधिक होगी और विश्व बैंक के अनुसार ये 2040 तक कम से कम 3 दशकों तक जारी रहेगा। इसे राष्ट्रीय अर्थव्यवस्था के लिए महत्वपूर्ण शक्ति के एक संभावित स्रोत के रूप में मान्यता दी गई है। बेशर्त हम कार्यशैली आयोग में जनसंख्या के कौशल को सुसज्जित और निरंतर उन्नत करने में सक्षम हो। भारत को मैन्युफैक्चरिंग हब बनाने हेतु रोजगार सृजन के लिए जनसांख्यिकी लाभ की आवश्यकता है। हमें कौशल विकास पर ध्यान देना होगा। इसमें आप जैसी संस्था के लोगों की अहम भागीदारी है, तभी आत्मनिर्भर भारत का हम सभी का सपना साकार होगा। मुझे विश्वास है कि आप जैसे संस्थाओं और अपनी जनता पर जिन्होंने आत्मनिर्भर भारत के पथ पर चलने का प्रण ले लिया है, मैं पुनः आप सभी को बहुत बहुत बधाई दे करके मैं अपने वाणी को विराम देती हूँ। जय हिंद, जय झारखंड।
थैंक यू मैडम वेरी मच। हमारा सौभाग्य आज अपने बिजी स्केड्यूल से आप समय निकाल के हमारे साथ जुड़ पाई और एसोचैम एज अ रिस्पॉन्सिबल चैम्बर इज टेकिंग नोट ऑफ ऑल योर वैल्यूएबल सजेशन एंड वी लुकिंग फॉरवर्ड टू वर्क विद द आइडियाज विद अ डीप सेंस ऑफ ग्रेटिट्यूड ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ एसोचैम एंड थैंक यू फॉर लेटिंग द होल वर्ल्ड एंड कंट्री नो अबाउट योर डिटरमिनेशन फॉर मेकिंग इंडिया सेल्फ सफिशियंट एंड जनरेटिंग स्किल्ड वर्कफोर्स। We hope our country will on the horizon of success in the near future. Now, I would like to invite a young professional brimming with innovative ideas, Dr. Sumit Susilan, Chairman Asocham Jharkhand State Skill Development Council and Chairman International Institute of Aviation Private Limited, winner of Yuva Pratibha Awards for vote of thanks and concluding remarks of today's inaugural session.
Thank you, Bharat, for giving me the chair. I would like to thank Honorable Governor of Jharkhand, Her Excellency Srimati Draupadi Murmu Ma'am, and Honorable Minister of Skill Development, Sri Nawab Malik Ji, for taking out the precious time from your busy schedule in this pandemic situation. As we know, right now the condition is in the country is really worse because of this pandemic, but still you had taken the time out from your busy schedule. And I really agree with the point of the on-job training, what Nawab Malik Ji had said, that nowadays the skill development side need more practical knowledge. So definitely we and the entire team over here who are looking forward to do more skill development in the country will look forward for more on-job trainings. Thanks a lot. Bharat Ji, towards you.
Thank you, Dr. Susilan. Under your able leadership, this grand event was possible. Once again, with a deep sense of gratitude to Her Excellency Srimati Draupadi Murmu, Honorable Governor of Jharkhand, and Mr. Nawab Malik, Honorable Minister for Skill Development and Entrepreneur Government of Maharashtra, for taking time and gracing today's occasion. We are closing the first part of the program, that is the inaugural. We move to the next part of today's program. There is a panel discussion which we are organizing under the able leadership of Dr. Jitendra Das, Director, Ford School of Management. Once again, thank you. I would like to thank Her Excellency Srimati Draupadi Murmu, Honorable Governor of Jharkhand, and Mr. Nawab Malik, Honorable Minister of Skill Development and Entrepreneur Government of Maharashtra, for joining us on this auspicious eve. And now, with due permission from Her Excellency and Mantri Sahab, I would hand over the stage to the chairman of panel discussion. I request and invite Dr. Jitendra Das, Director, Ford School of Management.
Thank you, Bharat Jaiswal ji. It's a pleasure to be associated with Asocham. Now we have this panel discussion, which is essentially focusing on Atmanirbhar Bharat. And we have with us six eminent panelists who will be sharing their views. It will be my pleasure to introduce them very briefly here. And we have a limited time available. So we have with us Ms. Jaya Mishra. She's a meritorious engineering graduate. She has done her degree in electronics and telecommunication from Pandit Ravi Shankar Shukla University in 2005 and moved into the professional life as a lecturer at Sri Shankaracharya College of Engineering and Technology around 2005. She completed her master's in electronics and telecommunication from CSVTU in 2009 with honors, and currently she is a PhD candidate with CSVTU University at Bhilai. Her journey from lecturer to the as president, the life member of Shri Ganga Jaldi Education Society, to the Director General of Shri Shankaracharya Professional University, speaks volumes about her multi-talented and charismatic personality and subtle substance and style in academia. I welcome her to our panel this morning. We also have with us Shri Sanjay Singh. He is the Director, Center for Technology and... Hello? Somebody said something? No, okay. I also welcome Shri Sanjay Singh. He is the Director, Center for Technology and Entrepreneurship Development. He is a graduate in engineering and postgraduate diploma in rural development. And he has been a chairman of Indian Industry Association, AMITI, for 3 years, and presently as a director for District Cooperative Bank, Sultanpur, AMITI District, Government of India. And he has been appointed a member of State Vigilance and Monitoring Committee, State of UP, for the coming 10 years. He has been actively involved in training, and he has to his credit of providing skill development training to over 50,000 persons and about 25,000 in micro enterprises in the various parts of the country. And CTED, which is the Center for Technology and Entrepreneurship Development, is implementing more than 100 schemes with a team of over 500. With these words, I welcome Shri Sanjay Singh to the panel. We also have with us Mr. Chandra Bhushan Chakravarti. He is the Vice President of Amway. And Amway is a very well-known company in our country, very well-known for what we call network marketing. It's a very unique way of turning a business from the consumers of the products. He's the regional vice president and has been working in the consumer goods industry for a long time. He is skilled in business development, channel sales, market research, management, and business strategy. He's a strong business development professional with a diploma focused in advanced leadership and skills from Devonport University. I welcome him to the panel. We also have with us Dr. Sumit Susilan. He's authored two books titled Airline, Airport, and Travel Management. And the second one is titled Introduction to Airline Industry. And he's also been a recipient of the Bharat Jyoti Award from the Chhattisgarh Governor, Honorable Mr. Shekhar Dutt, some time back. He also received Mahatma Gandhi Gaurav Samman from former Chief Minister of Delhi, Shrimati Sheila Dixit. He has also won Leadership Award in 2019 in Bangalore and in the India Achievers Award in 2019 in Delhi, and also Entrepreneur Director of the Year 2019 Award in Dubai. With these words, I welcome Dr. Sumit to the panel. We also have with us Ms. Archana Garg. She is the CEO and founder of Power Talk with Archana. She is a well-known speaker, a global coach, and a mentor. She works as a strong link to help individuals, entrepreneurs, executives to reach their success goals through skill development. She comes with a rewarding, enriching experience of more than 2 decades in business development and believes in creating an entrepreneurial ecosystem for sustainable growth and revenue generation. She's a strong proponent of inclusion and cultural diversity. She works for women empowerment and women learning by sharing her know-how and help hold them to tread the path of success. So we welcome Ms. Archana Garg to the panel. And last but not the least, we have Mr. Rahul Das Gupta, who is the director of Globson Business School, my counterpart there. He has been instrumental in transforming the academic architecture of the Globson Business School from a brick mortar to a click model, which is the requirement in the current times. And it is under his motivational mentoring that all elements across the board, which is admission, knowledge delivery, and placements, has been able to go through a seamless transformation, thereby positioning the B school way ahead of its learning curve and very well placed as far as the competition is concerned. With a legacy of continuous innovation in management education for nearly two decades, Globson Business School has uniquely positioned itself as India's only corporate B school, the world's largest business education alliance. With these words, I welcome Dr. Rahul Das Gupta to the panel. So that's the six very learned panel members we have this morning with us. And now we need to go deep into the theme that we are looking at today, which is Atmanirbhar Bharat. We have six speakers, as I said, and we have approximately now 50 minutes available. So what I propose to do is we'll invite all the speakers in the order that I introduced them to share their views for about 5 minutes. And once all the speakers have given their views, then I might like to ask a question to the panel. And if I feel like, I might direct those questions to a specific panel members and they could respond. So you could do this for about another 10, 15 minutes or so. And then after that, we'll open the panel for a Q&A from the audience. And Shri Bharat Jaiswal ji can coordinate that part, because the Q&A from the audience will come through the chat room or chat box communication. So the questions can be handled by Mr. Bharat Jaiswal at that point of time. So now let's start with Ms. Jaya Mishra. And you have about 5 minutes, ma'am.
Thank you. I'm really grateful for SHM for inviting me here and giving me this award. And it is really a pleasure to be here. Hearing you, Dr. Jiten Das, and also Mr. Chakraborty, it was an insight for us. I would briefly introduce myself. I'm a president of Sri Gangajal Education Society, as said by you. And I would also like to introduce my father-in-law, who has started this education society in the year 1994. He retired as general manager in Bhilai Steel Plant. And in those times, Bhilai Steel Plant was the backbone of economy of Chhattisgarh. So, and like, there was a brain drain of talent here in this state, and nobody wanted to stay here in this state because they were, lack of education systems here. So, that gave him the motivation. And in the year 1986, he established the first private engineering college, Bhilai Institute of Technology, here in the state. And in the year 1994, he started with nursery school of 37 students. Then in the year 1999, we started with our first engineering college. And in the matter of time, say around in four or five years, we were like 18 institutes. And we started with 37, and now we cater around 20,000 students in a year. And we have almost every branch from nursery to post-graduation. We also introduced our medical college in the year 2016. So we are also into healthcare now. And our motto is there's a motto, Gyanadev Tu Kevalyam. That is, Gyan Hi Moksh Ka Rasta Hai. So we believe in that, and that is how we are proceeding. And we are, contributing in, say, Atmanirbhar Bharat by training students, by giving education to these students, by bringing courses to this state. And so that they can get a lot of exposure here, remaining in the state and not has to go out of the state. We are also we host around 89 to 100 companies for placements here. Why? Because we have the greatest corpus of students under one roof. And to be precise, we hosted 93 companies as placement, wherein we our average package is 4.5 lakh to 17 lakh. So I think students are quite satisfied, and we are also satisfied to see how they are doing, how they're performing. And in term, we are graded as NAC has given us A grade. We are also ranked in NIRF ranking in the belt of 250 to 300. So that way also we are doing good. And also we are coming up with university based on the new education policies, where we will introduce courses which are not very not the traditional technical courses, but also skill-based courses. We otherwise also have all the skill-based courses, you name it, and we have it. Like we have PMKBY, we have Deen Dayal, we have Innovation and Entrepreneurship Development Cell. We were the first one to establish the first business
incubator. Your three minutes are over.
All right, I am almost done. I won't take another 2 minutes of yours. So the first business incubation center has been established, and we have already given a lot of chances to our students. If you Google TechB, there is a company which manufactured the cheapest and the reasonable 3D printers all across India. They have now office in India and also abroad. Like, they are the cheapest 3D printers available in India. I must not say cheapest, I must say reasonable 3D printers over here. So we have our own homegrown business from the students. And I think I suffice what I've said. So thank you so much. Over to you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much for letting us know the wonderful work that you are doing, and especially education is a very noble profession. And if you can bring in the skill in a city like Bhilai, where the students feel happy, it's a wonderful contribution to the society at large. So thank now you. I think we should have Mr. Sanjay Singh, please. And we'll stick to about 5 minutes, please. Yeah, over to Mr. Sanjay Singh.
Good morning. आज मेरी आवाज आ रही है?
हाँ हाँ आ रही है, लेकिन मध्यम आवाज आ रही है. बहुत मध्यम आवाज आ रही है. थोड़ा वॉल्यूम बढ़ाएं या थोड़ा तेज बोलें.
हाँ जी सर. हेलो. एक कदम आत्मनिर्भर भारत के स्किलिंग एंड वोकेशनल ट्रेनिंग और एसोसिएशन द्वारा आयोजित नॉलेज मैनेजमेंट वर्चुअल मीट एंड अवार्ड के शुभ अवसर पर एक विद्वान सर्वत्र पूजित को सम्मानित करते हुए श्रीमान डॉक्टर जितेंद्र दास जी, श्रीमान दीपक सूद जी, श्रीमान भरत जायसवाल जी, श्रीमान सीवी चक्रवर्ती जी एंड श्रीमान सुमित सुशीलन जी, सुश्री जया जी, सुश्री अर्चना जी एंड श्रीमान राहुल दास गुप्ता जी की उपस्थिति का अभिनंदन एवं आभार करना चाहूंगा. और बहुत सारे हमारे गेस्ट जो वर्चुअली लिंक्ड हैं, उनको भी उनका भी अभिनंदन करना चाहूंगा. सर्वप्रथम मैं एसोसिएशन द्वारा आयोजित इस भव्य आयोजन के लिए मुबारकबाद देता हूं, और मेरी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन जो कि सीटीईडी, जो कि अमेठी उत्तर प्रदेश में इस्टेब्लिश है, इसको बेस्ट एनजीओ स्किल डेवलपमेंट के अवार्ड के लिए सभी सम्मानित जूरी मेंबर्स को, विशेष रूप से श्रीमान रोशन जी जो कि एक्शन डायरेक्टर हैं, उनका हृदय की गहराई से अभिनंदन एवं आभार करना चाहता हूं. मेरा जो टॉपिक है रोल ऑफ एनजीओ फॉर स्किल एंड एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप डेवलपमेंट, इसको मैं अपने सीटीईडी की यात्रा से लिंक करना चाहूंगा, जो कि मैं इंजीनियरिंग की पढ़ाई करने के बाद मल्टीनेशनल फैक्ट्रीज में जॉब करने के बाद सिडबी का एक प्रोजेक्ट था, स्विस डेवलपमेंट कॉर्पोरेशन फंडेड, जिसमें हमें नेशनल टेक्निकल कंसल्टेंट के रूप में कार्य करने का चांस मिला, जिसमें हमारा जो रोल था वो एनजीओ के सपोर्ट से स्किल एंड एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप डेवलपमेंट कंट्री के 6 स्टेट्स में कार्य करने का अलॉटमेंट था. उसी पे हमें पता लगा कि एनजीओ क्या होता है. एनजीओ ऐसा एक संगठन है जो गवर्नमेंट के सपोर्ट से, देश के नागरिकों के सहयोग से, नेशन बिल्डिंग ऑर्गेनाइजेशन के रूप में देश के विकास में कार्य करता है. इसका कोई सीमित क्षेत्र नहीं है, ये एजुकेशन, हेल्थ, एनवायरमेंट, एडवोकेसी, ह्यूमैनिटी एंड स्किल एंड एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप के क्षेत्र में कार्य कर रहा है. कई स्टेट्स में ग्रासरूट लेवल पर कार्य करने के और स्टडी से पता लगा कि हमारा देश भारत, अगर हम टेक्नोलॉजी प्रोवाइडर इंस्टीट्यूट की बात करें तो पूरे वर्ल्ड में सबसे ज्यादा टेक्नोलॉजी प्रोवाइडर इंस्टीट्यूट यहाँ पे हैं. अगर हम किसी भी फील्ड की बात करते हैं तो सबसे ज्यादा टेक्नोलॉजी प्रोवाइडर्स यहाँ पे है। और विडंबना ये है कि हमारी जो मैक्सिमम एंटरप्राइजेज हैं, जो ग्रास रूट लेवल के एंटरप्राइजेज हैं, वो नॉन टेक्नोलॉजी बेस पे या उस पर कार्य कर रहे हैं। इसी के पैरेलल अगर हम देखते हैं तो हमारे 90% लोग अपना जीवन यापन अनऑर्गेनाइज सेक्टर्स में कार्य करके अपना जीवन यापन कर रहे हैं। इसी को फोकस करते हुए हमने 2004 में CTED की एस्टेब्लिशमेंट किया। और CTED का जो बेसिक फोकस था, इनिशियली सपोर्ट डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ बायोटेक्नोलॉजी, नाबार्ड और डिफरेंट डिपार्टमेंट के सहयोग से हमने माइक्रो एंटरप्राइजेस प्रमोशन में कार्य स्टार्ट किया। और अभी तक मोर देन 60,000 यूथ हैं जिनको हमने स्किलिंग करके ट्रेन किया हुआ है। और जो गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया की डिफरेंट स्कीम्स हैं लाइक RDP, ADP, NCRA, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी का स्टेट, ISTED, कई सारे क्लस्टर डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम, इन स्कीम्स के माध्यम से हमने मोर देन 2,500 लोगों को की माइक्रो एंटरप्राइजेस स्टेब्लिश करने में देश के डिफरेंट पार्ट में फैसिलिटेट किया है, असिस्ट किया है। और इसके पैरेलल हम जब टेक्नोलॉजी ट्रांसफर की बात करते हैं तो हमने रूरल लेवल पे उत्तर प्रदेश में और देश के और कई सारे पार्ट्स में फूड प्रोसेसिंग, कार्पेट वीविंग, बायो फर्टिलाइजर और लेदर, ब्रास, इन सब अलग अलग एरियाज में रूरल TBIs, जिनको हम रूरल टेक्नोलॉजी बिजनेस इंक्यूबेटर्स या कॉमन फैसिलिटी सेंटर से स्टेब्लिश किए हैं, जो कि हमारे जो विलेज एंटरप्रेनर्स हैं वहां पर जाके कार्य कर रहे हैं, उनकी प्रोडक्टिविटी का इंप्रूवमेंट हो रहा है और उस एरिया का जो फाइनेंशियल टर्नओवर, एनुअल टर्नओवर है, वो भी इंक्रीज हो रहा है। और साथ साथ हम जो GDP ग्रोथ में प्रॉपर सपोर्ट कर रहे हैं। इसी को देखते हुए इग्नू ने का जो PGDRD
आपका 4 मिनट हो गया है।
PGDRD जो कोर्स है उसमें हमारी अपनी बायोग्राफी पब्लिश है, गांव से अपना गांव की और टाइटल में। अगर हम स्किल डेवलपमेंट की चर्चा करें तो इंडिया में बहुत सारे कास्ट ओरिएंटेड, जैसे बैकवर्ड कास्ट, शेड्यूल कास्ट, इस तरह के हमारे डिफरेंट मिशन हैं जो ऑलरेडी सर्विस थे। लेकिन 2008 में NSDC का एस्टेब्लिशमेंट हुआ और इसके पैरेलल 2014 में हमारे यशस्वी प्रधानमंत्री जी के नेतृत्व में कौशल विकास और उद्यमिता मंत्रालय की एस्टेब्लिशमेंट हुआ। और 2015 में स्किल डेवलपमेंट को प्रमोट करने के लिए एक कॉमन नॉर्म बना। अभी पूरे कंट्री में अराउंड 20 मिनिस्ट्रीज हैं जो अलग अलग तरीके से स्किल डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम ऑर्गेनाइज कर रहे हैं, इंप्लीमेंट कर रहे हैं, लेकिन वो कॉमन नॉर्म्स को फॉलो कर रहे हैं। अगर हम स्कीम्स की बात करें 2 सेकंड्स में, तो PMKY, DDGKY, नई मंजिल, PMKK, NPS, NSKI, ये डिफरेंट स्कीम्स हैं जो स्किल डेवलपमेंट प्रोग्राम में सपोर्ट कर रहे हैं। और इसी तरह से अगर से पहले हम एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप की बात करें तो डिफरेंट मिनिस्ट्रीज हैं, अराउंड 20 मिनिस्ट्रीज हैं जो कि एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप डेवलपमेंट में भी सपोर्ट कर रहे हैं। और बहुत लास्ट में हम ये कहना चाहेंगे कि जो हमारा NGO का रोल स्किल डेवलपमेंट और एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप में है, कि हम किस तरह से जो हमारी गवर्नमेंट की स्कीम्स हैं उन स्कीम्स को कैसे बेनिफिशियरी तक हम कस्टमाइज करके उनको उसका बेनिफिट दिलाना है। साथ साथ जो ग्रास रूट लेवल की डिमांड है उसका हम नीड असेसमेंट सर्वे NGO करती है और उसके लिए डायग्नोस्टिक स्टडी करती है, उसके लिए जो पॉलिसी मेकिंग के लिए गवर्नमेंट के पास जाते हैं और कोई ना कोई पॉलिसी डिफाइन करने के लिए कहते हैं। हम अपनी बाड़ी को यह पे विराम करते हैं और व्याख्यान के दौरान अगर हमारी कोई हमसे कोई त्रुटि हुई हो तो उसके लिए क्षमा प्रार्थी हैं। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
धन्यवाद संजय जी आपका, बहुत ही अच्छा आपने जल्दी में क्विकली लिमिटेड टाइम में बताया क्या क्या आप करते हैं। और वी विल कम बैक टू यू आफ्टर ऑल द पैनलिस्ट्स हैव स्पोकन। तो हम कुछ सवाल मेरे मन में आए हैं जो हम आपसे पूछेंगे हम बाद में। फिलहाल हम चलते हैं मिस्टर चक्रवर्ती जी की ओर। सो मे आई इनवाइट मिस्टर चक्रवर्ती टू शेयर हिज व्यूज प्लीज। ओवर टू यू मिस्टर चक्रवर्ती।
Sure. Thank you, Dr. Das. And I had the privilege of sharing some of my views in the earlier address. And in continuation to that, I would like to bring a couple of points as food for thought. When we talk about Atmanirbhar, many of us are struggling with the definition of Atmanirbhar. You know, Atmanirbhar does not mean going local 100%. So we as a company, for example, we are into manufacturing of nutrition, products. That is where most of our turnover comes from, supplements. One of our biggest suppliers is China. You know that in this pandemic, it is vitamin C which is recommended by doctors, all throughout. Okay, and irrespective of the country you are residing in, and the biggest source of ascorbic acid is China. So when we talk about Atmanirbhar, I personally feel that it is looking internally, but it is also connecting all the dots, which is finance. So we are still to replicate what, let's say, a Grameen Bank did or a Professor Muhammad Yunus did in Bangladesh so successfully, and just see where Bangladesh per capita income is today and where we are. So we have Atmanirbhar means a lot of things. It is not just a clarion call that you decide to do everything locally, consume locally, manufacture locally. No, it doesn't. It means leveraging the global assets at hand. After all, the supply chain is global. You make some farmer grows something somewhere at one part of the globe. It is purchased in bulk at the other part, stored somewhere else, and ultimately manufactured somewhere else and sold where the market is. So nothing is going to change with respect to global supply chain. That is going to remain intact. I think that for us, we need to be very clear on what Atmanirbhar means, and leveraging to the best of the available resources. And I think that is one big piece which we need to get it right. And I think the second part is also so we are into creating entrepreneurs and grooming entrepreneurs. That is our business. Okay, and for 60 years we have been doing that. From our experience, I can tell you that what an entrepreneur needs is to sort out the capital aspect first, to have a requisite skilling to function properly, to have a market, and also we need to understand that what was working 5 years, 10 years back is not going to work now. Now, with the advent of gig economy, there are some economies like Spain where 75% of the economy is gig economy, which means only 25% is a formal sector, which includes the government as well as the private. And that is another trend which is happening in India. So we have to go with that. We have to flow with that. You can't buck that trend. So I think these are two food for thoughts. I think, getting the concept of Atmanirbhar right and how to leverage gig economy. This is what I think that if we can discuss, it'll be good, and it is directly linked with skilling and the issue at hand, which is creating employment opportunities. Yeah, Dr. Das.
Oh, that was wonderful. Thank you so much, Mr. Chakravarti. You are very much on time, and you did bring out a very important aspect that when we say Atmanirbhar. A lot of people struggle about the meaning of Atmanirbhar, and a lot of people want to take it the literal meaning of Atmanirbhar. That means you need to manufacture locally and consume locally. But then one has to look beyond, and you gave a very good example of manufacturing vitamin C tablets. Ascorbic acid, which is the base raw material, if it is coming from China, how can you manufacture vitamin C if you don't have an efficient supply chain linking up with China? So we need to look at these aspects, and the example that you gave of Bangladesh financing is absolutely wonderful. And we do have these self-help groups in India. A lot of companies are there, listed companies are there, but then we need to upgrade them to have a better reach in terms of ensuring the financing, because the it is also said that if there is a gap in anything an entrepreneur is looking for, the solution will be found, be it ascorbic acid availability locally or wherever. So as long as there is an entrepreneur who is delving deeply into a particular specific requirement, the entrepreneur will find a way out. So we need to focus on how do we strengthen the entrepreneurship ecosystem in our country, And so that's a good point that you raised. Now we can go over to Dr. Sumit Susilan for his views, please. Dr. Sumit, over to you.
Thanks a lot to Mr. Das for giving me the mic. Okay, so as we start, like as I'm saying that I am from the background of aviation, and we are focusing for the development of aviation in India. So in this pandemic, most of the people think that as the industries are going down, even the aviation industry is hit badly. Rightly, they like the industry, aviation industry is hit badly. Even tourism sectors are badly hit right now. But now currently, as per the Honorable Prime Minister vision, we are starting Udaan routes in India. So currently, with having 110 airports, we are going to grow with 435 new airports in India in next 2 to 3 years time. We'll be needing huge manpower. No one has touching this industry so far. People think only the engineering segments are growing or the media is growing. But if we look into this industry have immense potential to grow. And especially for tier 2 and tier 3 cities people. Because nowadays, if you are taking an example, if I take an example of Chhattisgarh, we are coming up with the airports in Jagdalpur, Ambikapur, Bilaspur, Raigarh. A couple of years back, we had taken an initiative to start our own airlines by the name of Air Odisha and Air Deccan in Chhattisgarh state. We tried, and Honorable Prime Minister had came to inaugurate these flights. But due to some technical issue that time, we are not able to operate that sectors. But finally, this year, again, after the pandemic hit, also, we can see it around 2 to 3 new airlines starting in our industry. The major issues right now they are facing are trained and skilled manpower. Right now, even if you see the pilots, in India, 60% of pilots are expat pilots who are coming from overseas and definitely draining out the economy. They are taking out the dollars from our country to their country. So our vision is to train more and more aviation people within country. If you see the top management of the airlines also are mostly are foreigners. They are not Indian. Why? Because we don't have a management college who teach aviation. They don't focus much in aviation. So we need a skill development in this segment as well as. And even as I'm also heading the training for Government of India for Bureau of Indian Standard for drones, I see there even potential for drones technology also in India. A lot of new technologies we are launching by the help of drones. Nowadays, as we are depending on Atmanirbhar Bharat, most of the parts of our drones are also manufactured within our country. Earlier, we used to manufacture and bring these goods used from China. But now, as mostly people are boycotting China goods and all, we are everything we are producing within our country. And there is huge potential now. So I think skilling within our country, it have a very good value. And we should more focus on skilling 2 to 3 tier cities people more nowadays, because they need job badly. After this pandemic, around 10 to 20 crore people are looking for jobs in the market. Every year, there are lakhs of engineers getting passed from the engineering colleges and looking for the job in the market. But they're not getting because it's not because there's no job availability. It's because they are not skilled properly. If they are trained in a proper manner, the industry need these talents to be utilized in the companies. So I think the right way, because with the vision of the Honorable Prime Minister, we had got a new education policy, the National Education Policy. It will change the entire system of the education, and we will be in the competition with overseas countries like US and UK, and people will now try to study within our country. Instead of going overseas, go for higher studies. So with this, word, I'll just take a pause and I'll give the mic to Mr. Das. Thanks a lot, Mr. Das.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Susilan. A very good take. I didn't know that you are into aviation to that extent. And aviation is going through a boom because we are a business school. We have been discussing as to how do we pitch in for the aviation sector. And, if you know, when an aircraft lands, and then when it unloads the passengers, and then when the passengers board and it takes off, the amount of work that is required is humongous. And there's a whole lot of logistics that needs to be fine-tuned here. And this is where the management education comes in. We're trying to explore as to what all we can do because there's a complete blank space there in terms of professional way of doing it. So maybe we'll be in touch with you later on. But I'll ask you a few questions later on when we come back to the panel. Now let's have Ms. Archana Garg to share her views, please. And you have 5 minutes, please. Ms. Archana. Archana ji, 5 minutes.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Jitendra Das. I'm really privileged to share the screen with the distinguished guests and all the panelists here. Thanking ASSOCHAM for giving us this opportunity to discuss about skill development and making people more employable. As a CEO and founder of PowerTalk with Archana, we've created a platform where we are delivering business skills and success skills to men, women, and the youth of the nation and make them more employable. Making a note here that, you know, hard skills and soft skills are no more the nice to have skills. You know, we have realized that they are must have traits in any individual to make them more employable and be successful and, you know, contribute to the economy of the country. So really to begin with, you know, I'm really happy to put forth and share that today the skill development program for women and men exists at every level and act as a catalyst for our economy and take a quantum leap in terms of empowering citizens and uncover huge opportunities for them to growth and contribute to the growing economy. Also mentioned skill development entrepreneurship program. Can I be heard? Okay.
Yeah, you're audible. Go ahead, yeah.
Okay, skill development entrepreneurship program, you know, so implemented also help us to churn out, you know, employable workforce, be women, men, or youth of our nation, right from scaling of very basic short-term programs to technical programs in skill development has been quite a mission to empower women and has come a long way for sure. From the very basic skilling programs like, you know, beauty, wellness, healthcare, tourism, to name a few, the focus has shifted to electronics, hardware, and other technical new age job roles, which are aligned to the requirements of the industry. And it is interesting to know that today, with the help of many projects running across the country, with the help of the government and the partnerships with private and non-government agencies, the skill development industry has indeed become very inclusive by way of creating ease of undergoing skill training programs for women. And skill development, of course, make women more employable. We see integrated learning-based programs that are incorporated to make women, youth, a more self-reliant resource for companies who hire them. I highly recommend apprenticeship, which can channelize women and empower them to take a formal employment in times to come. I would also like to make a point that skilled candidate is quite a relief for the organizations, you know. Organizations get to hire talented, skilled people on board who are aligned with the requirements of any organization, which gives them the ease of onboarding skilled team. Also, organizations have a lot of time saving there because they can control attrition levels in their organization, which I feel is a definite win-win situation for both the candidates and the companies who hire them. It is a great news, you know, for all of us that the new education policy 2020 has laid a lot of stress and focus on skill development at various levels for every one of us. And with digitization taking a big time leap here, I think it has indeed opened many channels and avenues for everyone across to plunge into employable development skill programs now accessible across, well, almost at most of the places. And this is indeed a clear indication that, you know, in informal employment that we all have been into, you know, people in maybe 2-tier or 3-tier cities, they restrict the earnings, which in turn affects the purchasing power of the common man that drives, you know, us like the consumptions. So I think it's very important, which in fact, it affects the supply and chain, which mars the economic growth of the nation. So very evidently, skill development makes women a more resourceful, is self-aware of her strengths. Programs furnish women to understand how she can rely on her instincts, go by her gut feeling, intuition to take decisions for not only herself, but also for the society at large. I think skilling gives us the power to be able to evaluate risks, push limitations, see possibilities and challenges, see achievements and struggles and accomplish goals. In fact, I think a skilled woman, men or youth for that matter, create a sustainable environment for themselves to plunge into entrepreneurship, in times to come, and thus creating more and more job opportunities for others also, you know, to benefit from, which I feel is a great thing, you know. And skilled women, of course, means creating a pipeline. You know, we are creating a pipeline if we have a skilled woman, because a skilled woman means a skilled nation, literally. A pipeline of uninterrupted, resourceful, and employable women which can go and add value to the organization they work for. We cannot negate the diverse teams make a better decision and propels the organization to take exponential growth. Diversity, of course, improves business outcomes, and it brings about positive growth patterns, as we see and perceive, support skilled women to be promoted in strategic areas of business within the organizations, thus contributing to a better revenue generations, contributing to the GDP of the country, and of course, growing economy. I would like to bring my thoughts on Skilling India to a close on a very positive note, that we are on our way to create a global footprint as economy is bound to take quantum leaps of growth with improved infrastructure, paving way to more technology-driven modern India, meeting the demand supply norms, a better GDP for sure, and growing economy. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Yeah, dot on time, 5 minutes exactly. So wonderful.
Thank you.
That's a very interesting thing you said about the skilling, and particularly the woman part. Maybe I'll come back to you when we do the questions to the panel. And now let's have Mr. Rahul Dasgupta, who is the director of Globeson Business School. Over to you, Mr. Dasgupta. Mr. Dasgupta,
Can you hear me now?
Yeah. You're audible.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Das, and good afternoon to all the panelists.
Your video is not moving.
Can you?
No, you're you audible, but your video is, I think it's a bandwidth issue, a connectivity issue.
Can I just continue? Let me restart it then.
Yeah, you can turn off the video and then you can continue. That may solve the problem.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yeah. You're audible.
Okay. So let me just start by, well, thank you, Dr. Das, and good afternoon to all the panelists. And it's indeed a pleasure for me to share this podium with all the senior dignitaries here. I think a little bit about the organization in a minute, quickly. So Globeson as an organization, we started in 1995, essentially into three verticals of business: technology, education and vocational training, and infrastructure. On the technology side, we essentially work on today on artificial intelligence. We have 1,000 people across India working on AI and machine learning. On the vocational training and education side, we are focused on postgraduate education, essentially a business school. And of course, the infrastructure business of ours is essentially into enabling and creating infrastructure for these youngsters to come and work and sit in, although the definition of infrastructure is going through a huge change in today's world. I think, you know, I've been involved in the skilling space for last one decade, and I think from the Indian context, and I think the challenge that which I foresaw, you know, a decade ago, I'm happy to see that a lot of it has been addressed, but still we have a very long way to go. If you look at the vocational skilling space in India today, there are essentially two major challenges that we have always had. One was the issue of aspiration. How do you make vocational skilling aspiration? And the second challenge, which I thought we always had, was how do you look at integrating the stakeholders that are involved in the skilling space? So if you look at who these stakeholders are, you have the government ecosystem, you have the corporates, you have the institutions and the universities and the training providers, and of course you have the students who are the main beneficiaries of this. The major challenge we have faced in the skilling space for the longest time is how these stakeholders come together and work together. And I think in order for us to become an Atmanirbhar Bharat, that's a very integral step towards it. So I think one of the good news, as one of the fellow panelists was mentioning, is that with the new national educational policy, and which has been sort of just rolled out, a lot of importance has been given to vocational education. And hopefully with that, you know, the students who are going to be coming into management education going forward will be a little more sensitized towards vocational training, and that's a very important step towards making something aspirational as well. And I think we as institutions and stakeholders have a very important role to play in it. For example, in Globeson Business School, in our postgraduate program, we are right now working on how do you include vocational courses as part of our regular PG programs. And we are working on different pedagogies and methods of doing that. So I think the onus of making vocational skilling aspirational lies on all the stakeholders. The onus of ensuring that these youngsters who choose that path of vocational education, get their right due in terms of jobs, opportunities, progression, relies on not just a government coming up with a policy, but all stakeholders working together to make that happen. So I think that's my opening remarks or points, and I'm happy to take questions after that. Dr. Das, over to you.
Okay, that's wonderful. I didn't know that you are a very old, reasonably old business school, and I'm sure you'll come with a lot of experience on how do we look at the education, particularly the management education. Since we're talking about Atmanirbhar, while listening to the panel members, I just collected one of the episodes in the Indian scenario, which in my view is a very classic example of how we can develop our own talent. This is a story we're going back to 1998, when we had seen this India doing this nuclear test, 1998, during the government initiative. And after the nuclear test, the United States imposed some what is called restrictions on India. And at that point of time, they banned delivery of a navigation system to India. The navigation system was to be used by the HAL, Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, for the development of that fighter aircraft and the LCA, light combat aircraft, which was being developed. Now, they were dependent on this aviation technology from the US, and without that, aircraft couldn't take off and couldn't go to its completion. So the US said, we'll not give it to you because you have done this nuclear explosion, and so therefore this technology can be misused by you. You could put it in your, missiles and things like that. So it was stopped. Now the DRDO, it's all in the newspapers, and that's why I'm sharing this. So DRDO and the Government of India, ISRO, they're all concerned, and the HAL were concerned that now this entire project is shelved. But then the scientists in Indian establishment, they started working on it. And in 5 years' time, India had its own navigation system. And they developed it, and in just 5 years' time. And today, Indian navigation system is considered one of the best in the world. And the classic example is the BrahMos missile, which is, at that speed, it has one of the finest precision in the world today as far as missile technology is concerned. What I'm saying here is the talent pool exists in our country. We need to do certain things so that a proper ecosystem is developed, which means the entrepreneurship ecosystem, the skill development ecosystem, the technology absorption ecosystem, and then, of course, the market which has to be there. The market has to be within the country, which is domestic market, and the market outside the country, which is export market. And that's how we can really leverage the talent pool of our country and reach the larger goal of the government of reaching a 5 trillion economy, if not by 2024, maybe by 2030. Even then it would be a wonderful achievement, given the current pandemic situation. So we need to work on how do we create that ecosystem of technology understanding, absorption, integration into our enterprise that we are trying to do. And then therefore, anything and everything that is required to strengthen that ecosystem, we need to look at. So with this thought, one question that comes to my mind, which is the link to what Mr. Sanjay Singh was sharing earlier on. He was talking of entrepreneurship, he was talking of skill. So with this thing that is in my mind, I would like Mr. Sanjay Singh or anyone else for that matter to share how do you see the entrepreneurship and skill development as something which is feeds on each other?
Yeah. So we can say it's basically as an entrepreneur, if he is having a very good vision, but उसका जब जो एंटरप्रेन्योर होगा उसका बहुत अच्छा विजन है, बहुत अच्छा कुछ कर सकता है, पाथ, बट उसके पास अगर स्किल मैन पावर नहीं है, वो कोई स्किल नहीं है, देन ही कांट सर्वाइव. द सेम थिंग, अगर बहुत अच्छा स्किल वर्कर है लेकिन उसके पास कुछ जगह नहीं है, वो क्या करना चाहता है, तो जब तक बोथ आर कोरिलेटेड, ठीक है, से अगर एक परफेक्ट ह्यूमन बींग है और बहुत अच्छा माइंड है बट उसका अगर बॉडी पैरालिसिस अटैक है, तो बहुत अच्छा सोचे, बहुत कुछ करे, बट कुछ कर नहीं सकता है. इसी तरह से अगर बहुत अच्छी पर्सनालिटी है, बहुत अच्छा बॉडी है, सारे परफेक्ट है, लेकिन माइंड काम नहीं कर रहा है, कोई विजन नहीं, कोई पाथ नहीं है, तो अपने आप में ऐसे हिलेगा, कुछ कर नहीं सकता. तो वी कैन से ओनली दे बोथ आर कॉम्प्लीमेंट फॉर ईच अदर.
Okay, anyone else who would like to add to this, the entrepreneurship and skill, how you see? Because see, entrepreneurship skill, you know, the way I see it is, you know, the need is the mother of innovation. Okay? If there is a gap, then somebody will find a solution. If there are entrepreneurs who are wanting to do something and then they are not able to find good people, people don't have that kind of a skill, there'll be organizations like being run by Ms. Jaya Mishra, who will take up those opportunity and come up and start developing the skill in those people. So it is only a time gap which is to be addressed, but then they go hand in hand with each other. So that's how I see it. So the entrepreneurship has to highlight the kind of skills which is required, and they cannot do it individually, so it has to be done at an aggregation level, such that the skill development organizations can take up those things and, you know, impart the skills to the people.
Dr. Das, may I just quickly come in on this?
Yeah, Rahul,
So I think, you know, I would like to speak for on this from the management education perspective. Now, if you look at a management education student today, when he goes through a two-year journey, essentially, you know, we break the entire journey into knowledge, application, and behavior, right? Now, if you look at these three elements, the management science essentially focuses mostly on theories, logical reasonings, and quants, and other areas, right? And we try to have these students go through an application of that, and of course, do projects and things of that nature, so that they are behaviorally, they become managers and leaders, so to speak. I think there's a space here where one can look at integrating vocational courses along with management theories. Because I think, for example, if somebody is studying marketing today in a business school and he understands the theories of marketing, but if there's a way he can also understand, let's say, a level 7 retail store manager's job role along with studying marketing, I think he becomes a lot more employable. He becomes a lot more relevant in today's world. And also perhaps, you know, it could be a pathway for him to become an entrepreneur tomorrow. So I think, you know, integration of vocational courses in PG program and curriculum can actually lead to entrepreneurship and better managers, which can sort of underpin the whole philosophy of Atmanirbhar Bharat. So that's something I just wanted to bring about.
Yeah, you have rightly pointed this out, because see, a business school is always in sync with the requirement of the industry, because the students who want to pursue a management education, they have only one objective in mind, and that is to get a good job. So that kind of a job or a skill is at a different level. So when you're looking at entrepreneurship, so when you look at the high-end companies and the MSME, so what kind of professionals are required for MSME companies? How many, what proportion of employees would be with a postgraduate degree in management, and how many would be typically what we call the skill-based jobs which are available? So we need to understand it from that perspective. So management schools are okay. They would fill that requirement. But when you look at the large pool of employment which is contributing to your GDP, is the, not only at the management level, it is also at what is typically the grassroots level. You know, like I came across some woman actually at my home who are working, you know, the maids who work. So she was narrating that her daughter got trained in as a beautician, and that's why she doesn't want her daughter to function and work or earn her livelihood as a maid. So she says, I have turned her into a businesswoman. She didn't use the word entrepreneur. So business karti apna, and she's earning so much. And she was in a village in Bihar. So she was saying she is actually a resident in a village. I brought her to Delhi and she got this little training here, and now she has gone back to the village and she's earning this much of money. And if I can earn that much of money, I wouldn't want to come to a place like Delhi to work in houses. So that's sure. Where the skill imparting is required. So when these people go back to the rural areas, that's where the Atmanirbhar thing would actually take roots. Because see, India is a vast country. You cannot have centralized the large factories where automation can kick in any time. When the automation kicks in, the employment goes up the roof. So we need to be sensitive to this aspect. So now let's slightly switch to the current pandemic situation that we have gone through. In business school, we have always been talking of, you know, when we have a pandemic situation, lockdowns, how do business enterprises cope with the situation, right? And fortunately for us, we have a very good organization represented today by the name of Amway, and who are in the consumer business also, as well as manufacturing. So I would be really happy to ask the question to him as to how Amway has been gearing itself and in terms of manufacturing and in terms of the supply chain and delivery in the pandemic and the lockdown situation. Any experience that you would like to share would be of immense value to us. Over to Mr. Chakravarti.
Oh, yes. Thank you, Dr. Das. Thank you for the question. And we had our own challenges. And the way I'll answer your question is I'll link the role of the product segment, actually, which we are in. I'll also talk, you know, I'll try and link the impact of shifting consumer behavior, because that has undergone a lot of change. Supply chain you mentioned, that was critical, actually. So I would like to talk a little on that, and of course, you know, leveraging technology. So I'll split my answer into these four segments. So yes, this ongoing pandemic has had its impact on all industries, and our industry, direct selling industry, is no exception. Now, being in the FMCG space and with a product basket which Amway has, which is dietary supplements, immunity building, household hygiene products, personal hygiene products, we were, better placed in terms of ensuring that we meet the demands of our distributors and customers. At the same time, while following all the laid government guidelines pertaining to the lockdown situation. And because we are dealing with products which are not only in demand, they are they are critical for every household. We had been very quickly enlisted as a product of essential supplies as per the list released by the Ministry of Food Processing and Industries, Government of India. So now that was about the advantage which we had in terms of our product basket, but. No point in having that if the customer does not see value in that. Yeah. And again, you know, we were in a great spot over here because this health crisis has brought a huge change in how the customer, you know, consumers perceive the need for supplementation. So earlier it was, you know, the companies like us, you know, who were dealing in supplementation nutrition. And we were trying to drive home the need of taking care of health rather than waiting for a illness and then going to the taking a medical treatment. But now with the consumers themselves realizing the importance of strong immunity that created a natural demand for us, and our nutrition category saw a huge increase in demand. Our home hygiene products, personal hygiene products, also saw a huge increase in demand. And while we have 140 SKUs, though few products like the Nutralite oil plant protein powder, the Nutralite Tulsi, Nutralite Daily, the natural vitamin C, we were hard pressed to cater to the demand. The hand wash, soap, oral care products, so on and so forth. Hygiene, the pursued disinfectant cleaner is often not available because we are simply unable to keep up with the production. Our challenge was to ensure that our distributors need to get those products which are in demand in the market, and which was primarily hygiene and immunity products. While initially in the month of April, due to the extreme lockdown situation, our business also got impacted, but slowly we could restore our supply chain and distribution. Our factory was not closed even for a single day. That is a support which we got from the government. And we could also ensure very quickly that the last mile connectivity in terms of delivery happened. So our business is almost back to what it was in terms of the pre-COVID levels. Another shift which we have seen is earlier we had 33% of our total sales which were digital, which were placed online orders, and the most of the sales was through our stores. But now it is the opposite. Actually, we have got 70% sales which are placed online, and only 30% is from stores. So the leveraging technology, and we have our digital first approach, and this is a global strategy. I'm not going to delve too deep, but the name itself is signifies that our digital strategy means that we are going to do everything and invest heavily to ensure our distributor productivity goes up. We are more engaging in terms of our consumers, and we are also going to strengthen our existing e-commerce platform. So I hope that could answer your question, Dr.
Das. Yeah, sure. Wonderful. So essentially, there's a lot of realignment that has happened in the industry because of the pandemic situation, not only in terms of the way people buy, but also in terms of the units who want to manufacture a certain kind of an item. So there's a swing in the demand of certain kinds of item. So you want to manufacture less of certain item and more of some other item. So that's a very interesting take. Now, while talking of these health products and nutrients, a thought came to my mind, and this is based on some discussion we had earlier on in some other forum, where we were saying that there are certain locations in India which could be very conducive for manufacturing high value health products. You go to the hilly areas or the areas where the water is, the groundwater is very pure, there's no farming done for the last 100 years, so the water is very pure, so you could manufacture these real organic products, but then those areas do not have the market. So if you manufacture something, you have to take it out to a place like Delhi and Mumbai and all. So by road, it's very cumbersome. But if you were to take it out through the air, so it becomes viable only when it is a high value item. For a low value item, transportation by air may not be viable. So therefore, my question to Dr. Susilan, I hope he's here, is with this Udaan thing coming up in our country today, with so many airports coming up, how do you see the Udaan contributing to the Atmanirbhar Bharat or the manufacturing base leapfrogging into the hinterlands of the country?
Yes, thanks, Mr. Das, for your question. Okay, regarding the Udaan scheme, it just said Udega Desh Ka Aam Nagrik. Okay, the Prime Minister's vision is to Hawaii. Chappal se Hawaii jahaz tak, everyone should be able to fly. So now even the manufacturing of major aircrafts are now happening within India itself. Like if you say Bangalore is being the base for the manufacturing of Airbus parts, Boeing parts and all. Even the graphic designs of these aircrafts are happening in Bangalore itself. So now Atmanirbhar Bharat, definitely we have more manpower within our country. Somewhere we have, what we had observed, that industry and training schools or institutes are lacking behind because they both are not in the same pages right now. Somewhere, if I'll take an example, people are trying to create new jobs, but they are not trying to save the job which people already have. But they are getting updated every day. There are some pictures nowadays are viral in all the social media where it shows the drone flying with a camera and says that within 10 years it had replaced a helicopter pilot with a cameraman. So that's truth right now. So now we should focus where we should upskill our manpower, not only to create a new manpower. So suppose right now is the case that where we are training new graduates for industry, there are the old people who are losing job and sitting at home. You know, so we have to see that part also. And if I'll focus for Udaan routes, if I say like 2 and 3 tier cities, like now it's getting connected. Okay, now as a training institute, what we are doing, we are creating a training institute locally in these backward places and training the students and candidates in that local place so that we don't have to deploy people from metro city to these villages because they won't be able to adjust in their weather and climate. Like take an example of Jagdalpur Airport. Now Jagdalpur have no connectivity apart of bus service, and if it's rainy, so if we have landsliding and all, people can't move out from their city. They are stuck over there. So you can't expect a person coming from Mumbai and settling down in Jagdalpur. So the best way is to train the candidate locally over there so that they can get a livelihood. So that's what we are focusing right now. And the way we are growing, you can see in this pandemic situation itself, our Honorable Minister Hardeep Singh Puri ji had inaugurated 3 airports. To, and that will be international airport they are inaugurating in Bihar, UP and all. So you can see every month 2 to 3 new airports are coming up. And even the Asia's largest airport, Zewar Airport, which is coming up in Noida itself. You can see how fast we are growing. And with the PPP model, the privatization of the airports, you can see all these airports will be one of the, you know, art of work of these people. Like Adani's had taken over 6 airports. So now if you can see next 3 years, these 6 airports will be in the comparison of Delhi and Bombay airports. So you can see how many passengers will be flying. And I think earlier people were having a mindset that only rich people do fly and rest of the people go by train. Now this mindset is already changed. If you compare a ticket fare of a Rajdhani and a normal flight are equal, or I should say it's go higher the train tickets because the amount of time you spend in a train, you spend in food and all, definitely is higher. So that's why I was recently flying from Bangalore to Delhi, and I saw most of the labor people were flying from one point to another. And I checked with them how you were able to afford this ticket. They said our owners are spending money on the ticket, and they're calling us back to the town so that we can work there. So now if there's no more mindset that only rich people can fly, even a common man can fly. And with the new airline starting up in India, you can see in future there will be huge manpower requirement for this industry, and we want like more and more training institute to take a part in this side. Even we have a new sector skill council formed under the Pradhan Mantri scheme on aerospace and aviation sector skill council. So now even this sector skill council, every year they try to train around 4,000 to 5,000 people. So I think in future we'll be having huge potential for this segment completely.
Yeah, wonderful. So I'm sure Udaan and the aviation sector will have a huge contribution to, improve, contributing to skill development in aviation sector as well as into the economy, right? So, Definitely. Now we are coming, we have had good take on this. But before I move to the Q&A section, I would like to ask an academic related question to Jaya ji. Jaya Mishra ji, are you there? Yes, in terms of, you know, you said about close to 20,000 students you have in your organization as a student. Any specific initiative you are taking to make these students think entrepreneurship or think self-reliant or Atmanirbhar in terms of training or practice or curriculum?
Okay, so I would just sum up in a very quick way. Whatever we teach like be it a course or a skill development course or a vocational training course or a business management course, there are two things which has to be kept in mind. One is like hard skill, as told by Archana, and also soft skill. In hard skill comes four things: the declarative knowledge, which is recalling a fact, concept, or a theory. Then comes your contextual knowledge, which is when to apply. Then comes your conceptual knowledge, why it is appropriate in a particular situation. And then comes your procedural knowledge, how to apply. If you teach all these four things and also with soft skill, I think you teach a student or a person how to grow as a human. And I think 20th century was a century to manage business. And in 21st century, you should always manage yourself. I think it's a self-management era which is going to come. And we all should focus on managing ourselves, how we are, you know, coping up with the situation. Agricultural era dekha humne, phir humne industrial era dekha, phir humne technical era dekha, aur ab hum ek knowledgeable era dekhne wale. So I think ye jo charo cheeze which I have put in, we are actually trying to inculcate all these things in our students by, you know, adopting all the new technologies, by adopting all the, like as said by Archana, you know, having all the great people in the pool to teach our students, because we are like, you know, we are in Chhattisgarh, we do not move out much. But what is going on outside, you know, outside India, outside Chhattisgarh, outside, you know, there are a lot of people who can exchange their views, knowledge, like you are saying here. Chakravarti sir is there, Das Gupta sir is here, you know, Sumit ji is here, who can, you know, tell us. So we arrange a lot of things, a lot of skill development course as well. But everything will sum up in only these three, four points, wherein how and when and what to apply at a particular situation. So we definitely are doing a lot of things in terms of practical knowledge. And I personally believe I do not go through, you know, more of a teaching method, but a practical method of learning, you know, organizing quizzes, organizing tests, organizing functions wherein they can actually interact and see what is going on outside. So, yeah, yes.
Good, wonderful. Thank you. Now, before I move to Q&A, one thought came after listening to her, is a question that I would like to ask Archana ji, because I found it very relevant in the current context, especially if you watch the TV, as to how the diversity, the inclusion at work or gender diversity is really important for ensuring skill development and the entrepreneurship across the nation. Any view that you'd like to share with us here?
Thank you, Dr. Das, for this question. I think this is really very relevant in today's scenario. I'll give you my example. I specialized in nutrition from Delhi University, and I forged my career in marketing and sales and operations, you know, and training per se. I am a trained cheese maker. I learned the art from Holland. I'm also trained to make handmade paper. I'm also trained to teach phonetics. I'm also trained to teach organic skincare, which I learned the art from UK, United Kingdom. The idea is to share that, you know, when we have diverse skills with us and we get hired by an organization, you know, we bring a lot of experience, a lot of different perspectives which can contribute to the growth of the organization and in turn the growth of the economy. Just imagine a box where we have people from same kind of experience, same kind of perspectives. We only see a linear growth of that organization. But a person who is coming from diverse experiences already in life, like I'm not talking about myself, but there's so many others, you know, you get so many different perspectives which can really contribute to exponential growth of the organization, you know, not only linear. So I think diversity is definitely very important. We have to encourage, because people are coming with different skill sets that contribute to the growth of the organization. Of course, inclusion is very important. We need to include, because see, everything is on paper today. You know, we have policies, we have courses, we have terms, everything. But how do we implement it? When we make it available for people to actually access it, use it, then it becomes inclusive, no? Like, for example, if I'm saying, okay, I want more and more women, I want more and more my youth to come forward and, you know, get skilled. But hum wo karenge kaise? Humne wo socha hai, humne usse kaise karna hai? Like, you know, Jaya ji rightly said, you know, everybody is, you know, putting forth their thoughts. Until and unless we make it very, you know, ease of accessing those skills, वो हो ही नहीं पाएगा तो हमें ईज करना है डेवलपमेंटल प्रोग्राम्स को सो दैट पीपल कैन अकोमोडेट एंड मेक यूज ऑफ दोस स्किल बेस्ड प्रोग्राम्स मे बी फ्लेक्सिबल ट्रेनिंग मॉड्यूल होने चाहिए मे बी एंड दिस इज ऑलरेडी हो रहा है इट्स जस्ट वी नीड टू क्रिएट मोर अवेयरनेस कि हाँ ये हो रहा है प्लीज इसको एक्सेस करिए एंड गेट मोर स्किल्ड एंड गेट मोर एम्प्लॉयबल लाइक मे बी यू नो वी कैन टॉक ऑफ फ्लेक्सिबल आफ्टरनून बैचेस फॉर वुमेन मे बी समथिंग विच इज वेरी लोकल बेस्ड ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम्स फॉर वुमेन or probably, you know, having a facility, a crash facility for women. Like, you know, we have it now all across a ho raha hai, so that crash facilities hain so that women can leave their children for apne bachcho ko wahan chhod sakti hain. Aur wo padhai, wo apna jo bhi unko skill karna hai, they can indulge in that skill. Which means we are helping them achieve that, you know, and get empowered, get more easily employable. You know, maybe have, you know, the remuneration they get. You know, to be at power with the other, the gender, you know, we have. So I think all these things are very important. Inclusiveness and gender diversity ko power dene ke liye, these are the few things we can do. And we can definitely look forward to a great nation. And I think we are already on that path. Hum already is raaste pe hain. It's just ke hum log sab saath mein aayenge. Itna panel hum log jo saath mein baith ke baat kar rahe hain. I think it's apne aap mein contribution hai. We can make it happen and we are on our way to make it happen. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. Wonderful. So we come to end of the first part of our panel discussion. Now we would like to have the questions from the audience. Bharat Jaiswal ji hai line par? So aap dekhiye kya sawal aa rahe hain logon ke. Or
we have one question for Mr. Rahul Gupta. Uh-huh. I hope Mr. Rahul Gupta is there.
He's there, very much there.
One question is like, you know, according to you, what is the major challenges that vocational training ecosystem in the country facing today?
So I think, you know, like I was mentioning earlier, I think there are two major challenges I've always looked at. One was the stakeholder integration problem, which is all of us, like the speaker before me mentioned, coming together, working together to make skilling aspirational. And the second is making it aspirational. You know, and if you look at the definition of aspiration, people have always asked me, how do you make something aspirational? You know, in our country, and I think there are two things that underpin aspiration. One is respect. Second is recognition. The moment you start recognizing and respecting a particular trait or a skill or a person, and in terms of the designation they get, in terms of the money that they earn out of doing those courses, you can start building an ecosystem which becomes aspirational. It's happened with engineering in our country. It's happened with business schools in our country as well. And the same thing can happen with vocational education as well. So I think if the stakeholders come together and if we are able to together make vocational skilling aspirational, then we would have gone a long way. And step one towards that is sensitization of vocational skilling. And I think the NEP 2020 underpins that very beautifully. And like the speaker before me mentioned, I think Archana, about inclusion of having women, men, all genders, all ages be a part of the journey. So if you are able to include people, if you are able to sensitize the ecosystem about vocational training, if you are able to make it aspirational by showing respect and recognition, and if the stakeholders work together, I think we can go a long way in skilling in India. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Das Gupta. So another question which came for Mr. D.B. Chakravarti. What are the opportunities coming our way with the rise of gig economy in India, and how is MWay gearing up, especially with respect to skill building? Mr. Chakravarti, are you there?
Sorry, I was muted, Bharat. I'll take that question. Yes. Yeah. And yeah, so so I'll spend a little time, you know, talking about the gig economy phenomenon first, and then probably where Amway is in terms of our preparedness in you know, working in a gig economy. And before that, I'll just put in perspective. According to me, this century is driven by four factors essentially, and the first factor is globalization. So, globalization is a self-explanatory term, but just to put things in perspective, you know, you have got Americans who are enjoying Indian brands, Indian cuisine, and we have, their McDonald's and KFCs of the world here. Another example is, the global supply chain, where we have already discussed how, things can be manufactured in some remote, hilly place somewhere, sold somewhere else, and the manufactured somewhere, and sold final end product ends up being sold in any other part. So globalization is the first factor which is driving this century. Second is digitization, as per me, and again this is self-explanatory. I'll not go deeper into this, but we all know that the digital world has become an integral part of our lives. The third factor which is driving this century, I think, is artificial intelligence. And it is artificial intelligence which has given our devices, our machines, an ability to forecast, to think. And the fourth factor is the Internet of Things. And why I give a lot of importance to internet is because it has played a great leveler in terms of giving a level playing field like never before. So in this backdrop, what happened is there was a huge race among the corporates to become bigger and to become faster. So I want to be bigger than my competition. I want to have more market share. I want to have more production, and I want to do it faster than others. Now, also what happened is that within the workforce, the organized workforce also started developing a preference for flexible work schedules. Now, that is not possible in a formal job where you can't dictate when you want to come, when you want to go. But what happened was that there was this urge of several people to prefer a flexible work schedule. And also with the advent of internet and internet penetration, it acted as a great connector between somebody who had a business proposal and somebody who was ready to execute. So all this jointly gave birth to something called the gig economy. And gig, what is gig? Just for those who are unfamiliar with this term, it is nothing but a one-time task which is contracted for a one-time remuneration, to put it simply. So gig economy is, by virtue of that definition, is nothing but a summation of all these temporary jobs, assignments, contracts in a particular market. And some great examples which you can relate to are Uber, Ola, Swiggy, Zomato. They are all part of this gig economy. And now coming to Amway, being a leading direct selling company, we are definitely making strides towards strengthening this gig economy system and working with that. And we have a stated global multi-year growth strategy which is focused solely on developing the power of entrepreneurship using social commerce, because we feel now social commerce is going to be the next big thing in terms of a global phenomenon. And in line with this, and in our endeavor to support the revival of the Indian economy also, we are focused on enabling a solid growth and a sustainable growth for our own direct sellers by creating new business generations for our distributors. Also, another factor which is linked to gig economy directly is, consider this fact that India is has one of the youngest population in the world. 65% of our population is below the age of 65 years. And as per a recent industry association report, in fact, this gig economy is growing at a CAGR of 17% and is likely to hit a total turnover of $455 billion within a couple of years span. So it's a huge thing which we are talking about. Also in the job market, what is happening is that there is a tectonic shift which is going on, and we are seeing a huge upsurge of people who are young, people who are below the age of 35 years. They are joining our business model more. And if I'm to talk about what is happening currently, even in this pandemic period, in the last 3 months, we had 64% of our total new ABOs who joined, distributors who joined, are in the youth category under the age of 35. So definitely, this is something which I wanted to share with the group. And coming to skilling, I have already mentioned that we have latched on to almost all initiatives which the union government has taken in terms of skilling, and we have partnered equally, and we are also significantly personally we are investing in training, education, and providing digital tools to our distributors. We are very serious about this, and to this end, if I talk about numbers, then Amway has organized over 6,000 training programs, and we are engaging with over 9 lakh direct sellers through the digital mode, and also consumers. Very recently, we have upgraded, and we have launched a very new Amway business app. We have launched a chatbot called Myra, and we have also improvised our e-commerce platform to make it much more easier for our direct sellers as well as our consumers to interact. So we are doing a lot of things to empower our direct sellers and also make it easier for customers. And to sum it up, we are in a sweet spot in terms of the business opportunity with the rise of this gig economy. And we are also seeing a quantum jump in people who want to start up their own business. And I'm not talking about only the Amway business. We are seeing an overall increase in people who are starting up their own business. And somewhere, I'm sure that this is also going to ease the pressure of job creation on the respective state governments and as well as the union governments. So we'll definitely continue to skill up our distributors and make them future ready. Yep, that's it, Bharat, over to you.
Yes, sir.
I'm really sorry to interrupt. Do I have a second to add to the gig economy that Dr. Chakrabarty spoke about? I completely endorse what Mr. Chakrabarty just mentioned about gig economy. I feel this is the future going forward. And, this really gives us the flexibility, in more than one ways. It's an offbeat from a 9-to-5 job to making opportunities available in not just one, but many sectors across. It's giving employment to so many people. And I feel gig economy is the way forward. It gives a lot of flexibility to people who have maybe taken a break from their career, or people who have maybe, they hold back not taking up a job because of elder care at home, or probably looking after children at home. So they can definitely step up and, take up, make use of gig economy today, because they have options available and people are ready to explore and give them an opportunity to come on board. Many organizations are doing it now today. So I think the gig economy is something that is really going to go very far, as Mr. Chakrabarty very rightly said, and make people more and more employable. And definitely entrepreneurship is going to come in a very big way, because the kind of mass scaling cutoffs we've had from the corporate sector this time, I think gig economy is the way forward. Thank you.
Do we have more questions, Bharatji, or
vote of thanks? What I'll be requesting, Chairman Saab, Dr. Jitendra Das, to to conclude the whole sessions. Your concluding remarks.
Well, we have had very interesting discussion on this Atmanirbhar Bharat theme. And we have had panelists representing aviation sector, representing academics, representing FMCG, representing skill development unit, So there is a mix of people who have been sharing their views, and we have clearly said that skill development and entrepreneurship, they actually go hand in hand with each other, and the infrastructure that is required is essential to make this Atmanirbhar Bharat a reality. So we need to look at it from that perspective, and the focus on ecosystem development for the entrepreneurship is very crucial. And one of the important aspects that was highlighted was that when you're looking at entrepreneurship or the Atmanirbhar Bharat, you need not necessarily look only inwards. You also have to look outwards also, not only in terms of the market, but also in terms of financing. The sourcing of material, sourcing of finances, the ways of doing things which is being done elsewhere has a lot of learning for us. So we need to be open-minded in terms of looking within as well as looking outside in terms of learning, understanding, and creating that ecosystem. So we have had a very useful and wonderful interactive session this morning and afternoon. And I would like to thank Ms. Jaya Mishra, Mr. Sanjay Singh, Mr. C.B. Chakravarti, Mr. Sumit, Dr. Sumit Susilan, Ms. Archana Garg, and Mr. Rahul Dasgupta for sharing their views with us and enlightening us and the audience with their insights into how they look at the Atmanirbhar Bharat. And I'm sure together we'll make it happen, and India will be able to move speedily towards becoming a Atmanirbhar Bharat. Thank you very much, and thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. With a deep sense of gratitude on behalf of ASSOCHAM, I'd like to thank you also for taking this opportunity and, you know, moderating this panel discussion, sir. And being in time is always good. So before we close this session, I would like to propose we have with us Dr. Sumit Susilan, who is chairman for Jharkhand State Skill Development Council. I would like and request him to propose a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Bharat. I would like to thank everyone for coming to this platform today and giving your ideas. And as a chairman to skill development, I would like to also contribute to this part that as we have all the educationists in our panel today, kindly try to take more industry people in your panel. When you are into education or you are into training, if you have more industry people with you in your training segment, definitely you will be in parallel to the industry, what's going on. You will have more knowledge about what industry required. You won't be outdated. So it will be my request for my side. And I would like to thank everyone today, especially Mr. Das, to moderate all this our event. And Mr. Rahul Das Gupta, Mr. Sanjay Singh Ji, Mr. Jaya Mishra Ji, Archana Garg Ji, and Chakrabarti Ji. Thanks a lot.
Over now to you, we are officially closing to the program. Thank you very much, Dr. Jitendra Das, for moderating this session. It's a pleasure hearing you. I would like to thank Mr. Rahul Das Gupta for taking time from his busy schedule and joining with us. Mr. Sanjay Singh, your presence was very highly appreciated. Thank you very much, Dr. Sumit Susilan, Ms. Jaya Mishra, Ms. Archana Garg, Dr. Chakravarti, and thank you very much. Thank you very much, ITT. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Congratulations.
Thank you so much
for getting this award.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.